Good morning, CSL family. Happy springtime, happy Easter. Beautiful day in Boise, Idaho. Rebirth is all around us and within. So today we're going to have a great music day for you, a great program for you. Thank you for being here in the sanctuary and online. We have Mr. Rex Miller, our musical director, on keyboards. Ted McClurg's playing bass today. I'm playing drums for you. My name is Phil Bowden. Most importantly, though, we have Miss Lisa Bittick-Lowe singing beautifully today. So let's get going.
Happy Christmas. Happy Easter. Thank you, Phil. Now is the time in the service where we allow ourselves to get present and settle in and get ready for this beautiful Easter service. where we make ourselves available and present and open and ready for some sacred invitation to the divine. So take a breath with me. Allow your eyes to lower or close your eyes. And sense and know the sacred right where you are. Absolutely, Spirit is present, and we are here by divine appointment to receive today this new day, this new life, this new way. It is my honor to introduce Whitney Browning, who will light the world religion candles from the Christ candle. In religious science, we perform this ceremony to acknowledge that all people and all faiths come from one great universal presence, which we call spirit. In lighting these candles, we honor the one family of humanity made up of over 4,000 religions and spiritual traditions throughout the world. We light the first candle for Christianity. Isaiah 43:18 reminds us, "Remember not the former things. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it?" We light the second candle for Islam, which literally means submission. It is the practice of yielding, letting go of the ego, submitting to the world of Allah and the serenity to accept the divine. We light the third candle in honor of Judaism that celebrates Passover as a commemoration of the liberation by God. A time of new beginning. We light the fourth candle for Buddhism. The goal of Buddhism is to let go. We light this candle for release. The fifth and final candle honors new thought, letting go of all that opposes your purpose, a reliance of the law of God, and an unqualified trust of spirit. So now we'll quiet our minds and we'll open our hearts for the message being sung by Lisa Bittick-Lowe.
When you can't find your direction and your heart won't guide you home, let go and let God. When your dreams are broken in the dust and you've lost the will to trust, let go and let God. Let the signs remind. breathes a dying fire, and there's no spark to feed the flame. Let go and let God. And when your courage fails you and the well of hope runs dry, let go.
Join me in prayer. We are present here today, surrounded by a powerful source of all good. It is spirit, God, love, whatever you want to call it. It is source of all that is. It's in me, and it's in each and every one of us present. It expresses as our own unique way, our own unique selves. It is God in expression in all of our colors, ways, personalities, present in the divine always, right where we stand. We are present in God. We are one with all that is. So it's from this place of knowing our oneness that I speak my word for this service, for this day, for this new beginning, for this life that we share on this planet. We're blessed beyond words. We are blessed with new possibilities and new ways of being for our higher selves and our higher good. I speak a special word for our Reverend Jackie, knowing that she's done her work today and Spirit expresses in and through her in her talk. And then it lands on fertile soil in our ears, ready for us to hear. So together we say Om Shante Ashe Amen. And so it is. And now our beautiful Lisa Bittick-Lowe.
Now we are not afraid, although we know there's much. to fear. We were moving mountains long before we knew we could. Oh, there can be miracles when you believe. Though hope is frail, it's hard to kill. Who knows what miracles you can achieve when you believe somehow you will. You will when you believe. Oh, in this time of fear, when prayers so often prove in vain, hope seems like the summer swiftly flown away. Yet now I'm standing here, my heart so full I can't explain, seeking faith and speaking words I never thought I'd say.
Where is my mic? You're not going to watch this, I can promise. It was hidden. I'm not going to tell you where. Good morning. Can we start over again? Let's start over again. Easter is about believing. It is about believing. And this morning, I believe that that will never happen again. Okay, I don't know what's happening here. All right, here we go. Here we go.
It's the little things, you know.
It's the little things. The Easter Bunny made me do it. Let's just take a moment, if we could, and recenter ourselves for just a moment. Recenter ourselves in this understanding of believing, knowing, accepting. Let's take a deep breath with me and let it out in an om, if you can do this. For the Trinity. Easter, it's all about believing. Whether you call it the springtime, whether you call it that renewal time, or whether you use that old-fashioned word Easter. It's all about believing. And of course, we know that Easter is a myth. We know this. But it's also the holiest day in the Christian year. And I think it speaks deeply to each of us. This morning, throughout the world, thousands and thousands and thousands of religious leaders are trying to explain this ages-old story, because it's much older than what we're led to believe. This morning, people all across the world are trying to explain this old celebration, this old ancient rite, what it means in terms of our own lives. What does it mean? And mostly this morning and last night, you'll find that they're mostly concerned with what Jesus was and how we should look at his death and his resurrection and how he died specifically for our sins and why we should be eternally grateful that he did that, even though we don't deserve it. That's what they're saying in most synagogues and churches around the world today and last night. Not in synagogues for certain. No, they're definitely not saying it in synagogues, but in churches everywhere. The truth is that you and I, frankly, had nothing to do with it. Jesus told us that. He said as much. Among his last words were, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They may not have known what they were doing, but Jesus certainly knew. As we spoke about last week, he knew exactly what was going on for him. He knew exactly what he was doing. He was in full command of himself through the entire experience, from his life to his trial to his crucifixion and to his resurrection. And none of us knows exactly what that experience was. We have no way of knowing. It's contained in the poetic language of the Christian Bible, and the language of the Bible, which was written years and years after this so-called event. And nobody knows for sure what part was actually true, what part is myth, what part is wishing, what part was made up, and what part never happened at all. So it's an out-and-out lie. We just don't know. So we have to recognize that this story of the crucifixion and the resurrection is symbolic. You will find the death and resurrection story in almost all major spiritual texts. It's in all religions. It's in all religions. Jesus certainly lived. I believe that he did. I believe a man named Jesus lived. And it is undoubtedly true that he was crucified for what he taught, as so many are who are different. And it's probably true that they rolled back the stone and that they found the tomb empty. It's probably true They probably found that the body was gone, but Joseph of Arimathea, or however you say that, might have taken the body away, buried it somewhere else, or, as some would have us believe, Jesus did not actually die, but he went off to India. There are others who maintain that Jesus and Mary Magdalene went to England, maybe, I don't know, because it doesn't really matter, because none of these various versions in any way change the underlying truth of what Jesus, the master teacher, taught. Jesus is not, in this philosophy, looked upon as the Savior. He is not considered the Savior. He is considered the example. So none of these stories, in any way that they are told, change what he taught us. Nor does it matter whether he actually appeared to his disciples, or metaphorically, if it was the truth that he taught that came alive to them. More people, by the way, have reported seeing Elvis Presley after his death than reported seeing Jesus, the master teacher, after his. It's a fact. It's a fact. During that time, if people wanted to see a resurrected Jesus, that's what they saw. One truth that this master teacher taught, which is so fundamental to the teachings of religious science, are that as a person thinketh in their heart, so be it. If you were looking for the resurrected Christ, that is what they saw. If they weren't looking for it, then they didn't see it. What you see, what you believe, will be manifest in your life. The power of the mind to create religious visions is no more evident in the example of the story of the crucifixion. Many of you have seen the pictures. You've seen the greatest story ever told. You've seen Jesus up there on that cross with the nails in his hands. That is not how people were crucified, ever. What would happen? I want you to get this vision in your mind, but for those of you who are a little bit more visionaries, think about what would happen if you were up on a cross and your hands were holding you up. No. What was common was for him to have had the nails in his wrist. That was how the crucifixion happened. And yet we see the stigmatas of individuals who have blood coming out of their hands because they believe. Because they believe. So the story of Easter may or may not represent holiness, but it sure as heck represents the power of the mind. That which we believe will come into fruition. The idea of resurrection is ages old, but never before the example of Jesus did it have such an impact on so many people that even today, we continue to reenact the drama of the crucifixion and the resurrection. I was driving down the Eagle yesterday, and I saw an individual with a huge cross on his back. Mm-hmm. He was crossing the street. Did anybody see him? He was making his journey. I really wanted to stop and talk to him, but it was in an awkward place. Imagine for a moment that kind of belief. In the ancient teachings, we know that the souls of the departed ones went through a series of purification on their way to becoming gods, stripping away whatever they were carried in their life until they emerged as true spirit. And only a few, we are told, are going to make that. But Jesus disagreed with that age-old teaching that only a few could be spirit. Jesus, the master teacher, came to teach us that we are already God. We are already spirit in expression, and that we are all going to make it if we want to. That we are already making it right here and right now, and that we will continue to make it in our lives wherever we go from here. He went through the experience with such authority that very few people doubted the truth of this. But today, so many of us are debating whether it's true. How can it be that I am spirit made manifest in expression? How can it be that I and the Father, Mother, God, infinite expression of life are one? How can it be that there is no separation from me and the great Creator that created all that is seen and unseen and all that is ever yet to be? How can that be true, we ask ourselves. Every week we come here and we talk about we are one, we are one, we are co-creators. And yet, we still deny it. We still, some of us with our Southern Baptist backgrounds, every Easter want to go back to get that feeling that we felt when all the preacher, the pastor said, accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and the happiness that came in our heart was all an illusion. It was all an illusion. The essence of Jesus, the master teacher, the essence of what he came to teach us was that the Christ consciousness is already incarnate in each and every one of us. It is already incarnate, and it is only awaiting our recognition of it. And that's the real reason he was crucified, because he was speaking the truth that was so frightening to the powerful that he was crucified, not to save us from our sins, but because he had the courage to speak the truth to power. We might want to take an example from the life of this magnificent man right now. The people did not want to accept their own divinity. And most of all, they did not want to accept the responsibility that comes with knowing that we are infinite spirit in expression. Up to now, the Easter story has largely been presented in terms of personal salvation, right? Demonstrating that by dying to the old, we can be born again to the new. And I believe that. I think that is absolutely letting go of whatever binds us, no matter how comfortable we may be with it, whether it's an addiction, an illness, a lack of education or an opportunity or a relationship, procrastination, any of the thousands of excuses that we have for living a less than fulfilling life. Letting go of our stories. When we let go of our stories, we're already in the resurrection experience. We are already resurrecting to the new. But it does take willingness. It takes agreement to let go of the things that have held us back. First of all, it takes courage to look at what is holding me back from the fulfilling, perfect life that I know and that everybody tells me I deserve simply because I exist and I'm an expression of God itself. Then why am I not living it? Ernest Holmes, our founder, said this: we love the idea of the resurrection, but it is very difficult for us to unwrap the shroud of our previous experiences. We all love the idea of the resurrection, he says, but it's so difficult for us to unwrap the shroud of our previous experience. We're all too familiar with this story, I'm sure. Most of us have spent most of our lives on some kind of cross. What cross have you crawled up on in your life? Mine was always people-pleasing. That was the cross I crawled up on, to the detriment of my own health, to the detriment of my own life. I crawled up on the cross of not enoughness, not being enough to accept this divine story that is truth. What cross have you crawled up on in your life? We're all bearing some kind of cross, and we get so fascinated with it that we can't put our cross down. I thought about that man that I saw on Eagle with this humongous cross on his back, cross moving like this. And I wondered where he got to his destination, whichever one it was, I don't know. Was it hard to put it down? Because wherever he came from, this had become his identity. This had become his journey, carrying this cross. Is it hard to put it down? Well, we know that it is. We know that it is. This movement, New Thought in general, and religious science and science of mine in particular, numbers the thousands and thousands of people who have experienced a resurrection. We've all experienced a resurrection once we've accepted the teachings of this movement, perhaps many resurrections, by learning how to use the power of mind to break through the seemingly insurmountable barriers that are in our lives. That's the power that Dr. Ernest Holmes spoke about every time he spoke. He said this line every time he spoke on the radio, whether he was doing a sermon in a church. Every time he spoke, he would say this: there is a power in the universe greater than you are. And you can use it and it can use you. There is a power in the universe greater than you are, and you can use it. You can use this power to have a fulfilling life, to have a successful life, to heal, to move forward, to grow, to let go. There is a power in the universe that is greater than you are. But you're one with that power. That power flows through you. There is a power in the universe greater than you are, and you can use it. And here it is. It can use you. Because we are the vessels, the voice, the hands, the arms, the heartbeat of Spirit Creator itself. Oftentimes, we don't recognize the crucifixion in our own lives, or we don't recognize them for what they really are. Good. Helping us. Gateways to higher consciousness. Ask anyone who is in a 12-step program about this. It's far more painful to stay with an addiction than it is to move into the program. Yet there are those who find it so difficult to let go of a way of living that has been comfortable. They find it so difficult to lay down that cross. Even knowing that staying where they are causes misery because it's become so much a part of their lives. I know that's true for me. Perhaps there's some truth in there for you. When I was in the advertising business, I had a peer, an account supervisor, who was a man a little bit older than I, but I was very young at the time, by the way. And he was so enamored with the beautiful people that we were doing advertising and marketing for, like Clint Eastwood and, you know, some of the big names that were, you know, in Hollywood at the time. He was so enamored with the beautiful people in the cocaine crowd, I need to tell you, that he wanted to be like them, one with them. And he destroyed his life by wanting to be like the crowd, wanting to be one of the beautiful people. Destroyed his life. Can you imagine a worse hell, having everything you want right in front of you, but not being able to enjoy any of it? Still hoping and praying that the next time will be different. It was difficult to watch this path. Giving up the old, whether it's an addiction, a job you don't like, or a relationship that's turned sour, is never painless. It's never easy, I tell you this. But few things I've been told are more painful than childbirth. I've been told this, I don't know. Right, mothers? Nothing is more painful than that in your life, and yet look what joy it brings. Pain can bring joy. Letting go can be painful. The resurrection and the light is worth all of the pain. What would have happened to Jesus' ministry? What would happen to all of us if he said, oh, heck, I give up, I quit, I'm not doing this out anymore, I'm out of here? What would we be talking about today? I don't know. But he didn't give up, and neither should we. Jesus knew what lay ahead. But there wasn't anything he had to do on this plane, on this part of the planet, that was any more important than what he was about to demonstrate. That life is eternal. That we are one with Spirit. That we are God in expression. From few forms of death, by the way, are more painful than the crucifixion. You can imagine being crucified, how painful that must be. And according to historical records, it took anywhere from 3 days, it could take up to 3 days to pass, at least many hours. But according to biblical stories, Jesus died in less than an hour. Pontius Pilate himself expressed how surprised he was, because once he made up his mind, there is no time or space or consideration of anything in God. And Jesus proved his point. Even though the people of Jerusalem had cried, crucify him, crucify him, one by one, more and more people were beginning to understand his teaching. And individually now, more and more of us are becoming aware of the teaching of our oneness with God and with each other. So there are two aspects to, I think, the resurrection story, the crucifixion and the resurrection story. The first aspect is that it's individual for each and every one of us, that we are all letting go, resurrecting our lives, crucifying that which does not work for us. We are all doing this, or we are attempting to do this. We are beginning to understand that we are co-creators with God, and that all of the experiences we have authority over, we have choice over. On an individual level, I believe that we are waking up. Every person within the sound of my voice certainly is, or you wouldn't be listening to this. We've been so caught up with doing our own thing that we do tend to forget, however, that there's a second aspect to, I think, the resurrection story. And it is the resurrection story of humankind. Humankind. The second coming, I like to call it. Because I believe just as we are waking up, our world is waking up as well. As we are evolving in consciousness, each one of us is putting a drop of higher consciousness into this idea of race consciousness, and we are literally changing the world. One person at a time, waking up individually, wakens up all of humanity. I believe this. It's not a political or a cultural process, but it's a spiritual process. It's a spiritual process that is taking place right now in the medium that all of us share called universal mind, because we are all one. We are all one. When I was teaching youth church with the little ones one time, we had a process that we would do with the children, and I've told many of you this story before. We would have a glass, and I should try to do this. I forget. See, I make these things up on the spur so I don't come prepared. But we would show the children clear water. And it was beautiful. And then we would take some Indian ink, indigo ink or whatever you call it, and we would say something negative. He's so ugly. And we would put a drop in. Oh, whatever. I'm too small. I'm not educated enough. We'd put a drop in. And soon, this is race consciousness here. That's what this is, race consciousness. Soon it was cloudy. Soon it was dark. And then we took Clorox and we dropped it in, drop by drop, as we said positive affirmations. Beauty, love, peace, and it cleared up. This is the second coming I'm talking about. That you, because you are waking up in consciousness, you are adding the clearing, the clarifying thought into race consciousness. Yes, it feels dark. Yes, it feels bad. Yes, we don't want to put water on my phone. I know that it does. But I also know with every positive affirmation, with every act of goodwill, with every change in belief system, we are literally clearing out the channels and the consciousness of humanity. The real action is taking place in the soul of humankind. It's here where the idea of oneness is beginning to grow. It's here where we are finally catching on at the subjective level that all of us can feel our connection with each other, with those that are suffering in Israel and Gaza right now, that those are suffering anywhere in the world. Our soul feels that, and we can, through our own affirmative belief system, change the consciousness of this world. Are you with me on this? We can have a second coming. The Christ is not coming back. The Christ is already here. And it's you, and it's me, and it's everyone. The second coming happens every time a baby is born. And every time we wake up and remember who and what we are. Who and what we are. I want you to know that I believe with all of my heart that this is the only way that we are going to end wars. It is the only way that we are going to end separation and hunger and hurt and pain in this world. It will not be done by our politicians. It will not be done by our world leaders. It will be done by each and every human being on planet Earth awakening to their own divinity, recognizing it in each other, understanding that we are one family. And what hurts one member of our family hurts all of us. That's the second coming. That's the resurrection that I know is taking place right now. I pray, I hope, and I believe that I'll see it happen in my lifetime. I hold that truth to be absolute, that this resurrection of oneness and love and understanding, compassion and acceptance, enoughness and overflowing abundance is the truth for all humanity. That's the story. But first, it has to start individually. Did all of you receive a rock? Is there anyone who did not receive a rock? Just hold up your hand and Bev's going to come to you. Musicians, we want to give you a rock. Well, we're going to bring you rocks. Anyone in the congregation did not get a rock? And as she's handing out the rocks to or allowing them to select their rocks, I want to say that this idea of conscious evolution, this eventual emergence of the universal conscious mind, is already so well established that it has to manifest. It must. It cannot not manifest. This is what I'm saying to you. And it doesn't take a lot of people, doesn't take a lot, many people knowing the truth to manifest it, because all the power of the universe will support it when one or two. Many of you know that Bill W., the co-founder of Alcoholics Anonymous, the greatest self-help movement in history, had the idea for this quite a while. He had it quite a while in his life. But it didn't happen until he shared it with another person, Dr. Bob. And the result of that simple sharing led to the salvation and the resurrection of millions of people from the denigration of addiction. So what I'm trying to say is, you all have an idea of goodness. Share it with someone, and it will manifest in your life and in theirs. So let's just take a moment, if we could. And I want you to hold your rock in your hand. Everyone except Rex Miller. And he's going to glance at his rock every once in a while. Let's just take a deep breath. When you walked into the door this morning, the lobby this morning, you were asked to pick up a rock. We didn't hand that rock to you. I didn't choose your rock for you. You chose your rock. Maybe, like my rock, there was a vibration that said, pick me, pick me. Or maybe you just looked down at those rocks and said, yeah. Some of you got a rock that has some residue on it. That's just wax, by the way. But I deliberately did not clean that because this rock represents a burden that you are carrying in your life. Something that is holding you back. And for those of you who got something with residue on it, that's how it is, isn't it? The world just keeps piling it on and piling it on. And what was a little pebble in your shoe becomes a gigantic boulder. That's how it works. And so I want you to take this rock, and I want you to do it. And I want you to, do you have one, Lisa? Beverly? Some people up here need some rocks. You can't choose for them. I want you to look down at the rock that you chose. And let's just turn the lights out if we could. Let's turn all the lights in the sanctuary. And for just a moment, I want you to enter into the darkness of the heaviness and the weight that this rock represents to you. Fear. Worry. Concern. to rock is an illness. Perhaps your loss, your rock is about loss. The loss of yourself or a loved one. Hold this rock. Enter into the darkness with me for a moment. Heaviness to you. Just hold it. Can you let it go? Can you let it go? Letting go can be scary, and it can be painful. In a few moments, we're going to ask you, when you're ready to let go, to get out of your seat and to walk through the dark curtains in the back of the room, representing stepping into the darkness. Be willing to step into the darkness. You'll notice that you're walking on red rose petals when you go through the door of darkness. Representing all of the blood, sweat, and tears that you have expended in holding on to this, whatever it is. And when you go through the darkness, you're going to be asked to place your rock on the altar of release. From there, you will be guided to the sacred smoke for a cleansing ritual to cleanse you of all that has held you back. And then you will be guided to a flower, to select a flower, representing what you are willing to pick up now, what you are willing to accept, what quality you are willing to embrace in your life. There'll be practitioners out there to pray with you or to be with you if you need that. And then you will enter through the curtains of light. You'll enter into the lightness, walking on the white rose petals, representing new life. So let's just move within for a moment. Just walk through the curtain of darkness. Quietly, no words.
Snow glows white on the mountain tonight. Not a footprint to be seen.
Oh,
anyway. You're broken down and tired of living life on the merry-go-round, and you can't fight the fighter, but I see it in you, so we're gonna walk it out. Move mountains, we're gonna walk.
Dino says that the greatest miracle in the world is where a human being comes back from the living dead. Too often we get beaten down in life and we feel hopeless and helpless, and we believe that our lives won't get any better. I've met a lot of the living dead. I've been the living dead myself. And although we were breathing and moving around, we weren't really living. We were merely existing. I've been one of those people. And I suspect that you too have walked that path as well. The Easter message is one of hallelujah and encouragement to reawaken and come back from the living dead. to live more joyously, more vibrantly, with hope and enthusiasm. That's the miracle of Easter. And we do that by believing. Long before he was resurrected, Jesus believed that he would rise from the dead. It was foretold, and he believed it. Nobody else did, but he believed it. Because the achievement of anything begins with believing. It begins with believing. All things are possible to those who believe, he said. He was powerful because he lived every moment of his life from that affirmation. And he lived every moment of his life from the understanding that we have to let go and we have to rise up again so that we can live.
Won't just survive, oh, you will see me thrive, can write my story, I'm young. So little faith, don't doubt it, don't doubt it. Victory is in my veins. I know it, and I will not negotiate. I'll fight it, I'll fight it. I will transform. When the fire's at my feet again, and the vultures all start circling, the peace parade.
Power that is greater than yourself, that has a greater plan and possibilities for your life? Are you willing to open your heart and believe that whatever you're going through can be healed, can be transformed? We can experience the resurrection when we understand that in order for there to be a resurrection, there has to be a crucifixion. In order to be born anew to something, you have to die to something old. That's a universal principle. The old leaves have to fall off the tree and die in the fall so that they can be born as new leaves in the spring. You have to prune away the dead branches on a rose bush so that blossoms can come in the spring. The caterpillar has to die to its old self so that it can be transformed into the butterfly. I know the idea of crucifixion is painful and hurtful, and we tend to think of letting things die, that means we're going to lose something. But that isn't what it means. We're afraid to let go of things, even when they're hurting us, because it can create a sudden vacuum in our lives. But this is what we know. Nature abhors a vacuum. And I promise you, when you let this go, when you rise up to that which you know is yourself, all of the hidden ideas within you will rise up. And your life will be made beautiful. You have another song? All right. The third thing we have to learn in order to experience the resurrection is that transformation takes time. Jesus died and was put in a tomb, and there he remained, so the story goes, for 3 days until the resurrection. What happened in that silent, still tomb? What happened in that darkness? Nobody could see what happened, but something amazing and transformative happened that only Spirit could have made happen itself. What happens when we plant a seed? What happens underneath the ground that we can't see that provides power for that plant to grow and burst through the earth? What is that invisible power? We don't know, except that it's a universal law in mind. The transformation of the seed is happening in a secret place that we can't see, but we still trust. We plant a tomato plant every year, and we do not expect cucumbers from that plant. We trust and know that the seed that was a tomato seed will transform itself into a tomato. We trust it. We believe it. If Jesus had wanted to demonstrate a miracle, why didn't the resurrection just happen right away? Don't you think it might have had better impact if he had died on the cross and then all of a sudden taken a deep breath and said, kidding. I don't know. Maybe it would have had a bigger impact. But there was a message for us there. And the message was that real transformation takes time. I know we want to put that rock in that place today and pick that new flower up that represents the new thing that we are embracing right now and that we want to happen. We want it to happen instantly, right this minute. And I'm not saying that it's not going to, but I'm saying that often true transformation takes time and we can't mess with it. You can't put your fingers into that butterfly, that mess that soon the cocoon of the butterfly will emerge from. You can't do that. You've got to let it happen. My teacher, Dr. Michael Beckwith, says we can have anything we want, but first we must become it in consciousness. Today we ask you to choose your rock. We didn't choose it for you. We ask you to make the decision about what is holding you back. And then we ask you to choose a flower, whatever it was that called to you. We ask you to choose that. We can't choose that for you. We know that whatever it is that you are ready to crucify in your life and rise to the new, that can happen. That can happen in an instant. You were given a flower and you were also given a packet of seeds, and those seeds are giant sunflower seeds, and you were given 10 sunflower seeds because we want to give you 10 chances for success. Because sometimes we try and it just doesn't work. We know, though, that if you plant that, it's going to grow between 8 and 12 feet tall. We know that because we've done this in the past, haven't we, Cindy? Cindy sent us a picture of her gigantic sunflower that she grew from seeds that was given to her a few years ago. But this year we're going to do something else as well, and that is on every table on the sides, we have given you the opportunity to pick up a plant, what is this called, a plant steak. No, a steak. Not that kind. This kind. A plant steak. And what we want you to do is get some yummy Easter sweets and something to drink, and then go over to one of the tables, and there's all kind of markers, and we want you to write whatever it is that you are accepting in your life, and we want you to plant those seeds, and we want you to put that in back of that seed and watch it grow. You can even write an affirmation. Also on each table, there are 10 affirmations. They're turned upside down. What I'd like you to do is don't look at them. Let Spirit guide you to the affirmation that is for you today. On each of those tables, they all have the same affirmations, but I'm saying there's 10 different ones. So let Spirit. So after service, we're asking you to do that or take it home, and you can take two or three. Take as many as you want. And we have more seeds. Do we have more seeds? So we're going to leave the basket there under the heart light. And if you want to pick up some more seeds and give them to your neighbors, give them to your friends, anywhere you want to bring some beauty, feel free to give these out. I'd like to see no seeds left when we come. I wish you all a blessed and beautiful, magnificent resurrection season. Let's just take a moment and turn within. And right where you are, I would like to invite you to stand up and find two other people, maybe two people you didn't come with. Move around, please. Just move around the room and find two other people very quickly. And when you found your people, fall into the silence. Could I get you to fall into the silence? Here's a three right here. And there's a three. Who needs a partner? Who needs a group? Just walk around and find a group. Okay, we can't do this till you stop talking. Actually, they have to say hello, don't they? you two came together. That's all right. Will you join this group right here, Deborah? All right. Introduce yourselves real quick. First names. And now go around the group again. And I want you with one word or two words, whatever works, but no more than two. All right, no more than three. All right, no more than three words. I want you to speak an affirmation about what that flower stands for in your life. Why did you pick that flower? What is your affirmation? My flower stands for love. Join that group. When you've completed that, hug each other and sit down. Give somebody a hug and sit down. I'm giving you all one giant hug. And all of you who are at home, we just know you can just post right here on the live feed, whatever you are affirming for Easter. Also, for those of you who are at home on watching YouTube or Facebook at any time, please send a message to office@cslboise.org, office@cslboise.org, and let us know that you would like some seeds and a plant and a stake, and we will get it to you. We will mail it to you, and we will make sure, so don't give all the flowers away. So just let us know, and we will be happy to give that to you. Also, y'all, those of you who do plant it, when it comes into manifestation, I would love it if you would send a picture to office@cslboise.org with your affirmation and what it stands for. As it grows, so grows your belief. In your packet, you will find directions on how to plant it and also an affirmation by our founder, Dr. Ernest Holmes. So this was our prayer time. I just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you, God. Thank you, Spirit. Thank you, life. How good it is to allow the death of anything in our lives that is not working. Thank you, Spirit, for allowing us to be the messengers of change in the world. Thank you, God, for allowing us to be the hands, the voice, the heart, the mind, the expression of the Creator itself, and most of all, thank you for the opportunity in every moment to be born anew. For this, and for peace, and love, and joy, and oneness, and abundance, prosperity, and all good, we do give thanks. And so it is. Amen, amen, amen. We will do our thank yous and all of those great things next week. All the volunteers, you know who you are. There were so many of you that helped us. Thank you, thank you, thank you, blessed ones. Thank you for those of you who continue to support the Center for Spiritual Living, particularly those who are online who send in your offerings. Thank you. We are so blessed. Let's just take our gift, our offering in our hands right now and realize that this represents the abundance of spirit, of love, of life itself. Oh, thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. And for this and so much more, we are deeply grateful. And so it is. Amen, amen, amen. If you are with us for the very first time today, we welcome you. Please stay for hospitality and get to know someone. And please fill out this welcome card, which will put you on our e-blast, letting you know everything that's happening in the church. Don't eat too many sweets, but enjoy the rest of your day. Happy Easter. Peace and blessings.
We'll fall down, we get banged up, but the stars show how love heals us. Don't you look back, lift your head up, shake the dust off. hear you. I can't hear you. Breath in our lungs, beat in our hearts. Pick up your voice, you got something to say. It's a brand new day. It's a brand new day.
Receive your blessing. Hold your hands up. I accept that we rise through any circumstance, and I bless you with all of that. And so it is, and so we let it be.
Yes. Thank you.